IVM.
The thing with poker is, and something I'm sure even you've kind of figured out, is that it is one of those games which is on the intersection of science and gambling. There is a science to it where you can study the game theory and you can know, oh, this is game theory optimal, my ranges are balanced here, this is how I exploit his mistakes. But a lot of people that you play with are basically addicts. It's like a drug for them.
My guest today is a fellow podcast host, which is liberating in its own way. He hosts one of the most listened to podcasts in India called Seen and the Unseen. He's a celebrated journalist and winner of the prestigious Bastiat Award. He used to be the managing editor of Crick Info and is a columnist on different platforms. But the most interesting thing about Amit Varma is he and I have three common passions, or you can say addictions. One is analytics. The second is cricket, and the third is poker. So we decided to bring all three of them together in this episode. Let's see how this goes. Welcome to the Filter Koffee Podcast, Amit.
Thank you. Honored that you invited me.
Same here. I've been looking forward to this for a fairly long time. I'm very happy we found time mutually, finally. I want to start off this episode by asking you, how does Amit watch sport? Are you the romantic, or are you the statistician?
I'm a schizophrenic. So to answer that, I'm basically both. But actually, I think that might just be a false binary. So obviously, you know, when you're a kid, you're watching sport because there are certain players you like and you want to see action and you want your team to win. And that's why you kind of watch the sport. I was a cricket journalist for a few years in the last decade. I was managing editor of Crick Info for a few years. I covered the sport that way. But I think what changed the way I look at sport and perhaps life in general was I spent 5 years as a professional poker player at the start of this decade. And that kind of got me trained to looking at the world in probabilistic ways. Now, what that basically means is that what tends to happen in sport, for example, is that everything becomes a binary. After something happens, it has 100% happened. If it doesn't happen, it has 0% happened. And it's all 100 and 0. But when you think about the game probabilistically, you realize that it's not as cut and dried. For example, if, say, Rohit Sharma in a test match, he's come out at 6, he stabilized the innings a bit, but is still wonky. And then he goes for a 6 and he gets caught at mid-wicket. Now, the thing is, at the time he placed that shot, the shot has a certain expected value to it. A probability that it'll go for a 6, a probability that he'll be out, and so on and so forth. What typically happens is that if it does go for a 6, people will say, wow, he's, you know, shifting the momentum, putting the pressure on the bowlers, and now the bowlers will have to vary their lengths, and so on and so forth. And if he gets caught out on the boundary, they'll be like, oh, bad shot selection, he let the team down again, why is he playing test cricket? Yeah. While actually what happened in both cases was the exact same thing. And Indian cricket fans especially, tend to be too focused on results and too results oriented. And what professional sportsmen, I think, have figured out is they look at the game differently. They're process oriented, where the question is, are you doing the right thing? Understanding that a lot of the result is luck, it's randomness.
You know, what you said brought to mind this term that we often use, which is the percentage game, right? Especially when we're watching cricket, you hear this a lot, right? I'm contrasting that with something that Sachin has said at many points in his career, which is you're really, really playing well when you're not thinking at all. Your subconscious is playing, right? I think he said that in response to, you know, when someone recently asked him about that over 0.6 of Shoaib Akhtar. Did he plan it? I said, no,
2003.
I was in form and I just played it. It came to me. I thought that was the right, this thing, right? Do you think, from a cricket perspective, before we move into poker, do you think players actually can play a percentage game?
I think, I don't think there's a contradiction there. Mm-hmm. I think, like, obviously a batsman is not thinking about a particular stroke he'll play. It's instinctive. You spend thousands of hours in the nets and what comes, comes. But what you can do is you can shape your intent. For example, when Sachin himself, if you'll remember that famous tour to Australia, where he was recovering from tennis elbow, and in fact, right. I happen to know that at one point during that time, his elbow was so bad he couldn't lift a cup of tea. That's how bad it was. and he also found he was getting out, on the playing a particular shot through the offside. And he just said that, okay, I'm not going to play that shot.
That's a Sydney test.
He made a double hundred. The thing is, what he did simply there was all the shots he played were still instinctive, but he carved out a certain number of them and didn't play those. So similarly, a batsman in the, say, 45th over of an ODI will play the same way as, in terms of relying on his instincts, will rely on his instincts as much in the 45th over of an ODI as in, say, the first session of a test match. But his intent will be different, and therefore the strokes that he is considering, which are in the menu of possibilities he has given to himself, will be very different. So I don't really think there is a contradiction there.
You don't think that there's not a zero-sum game there, right?
No, I mean, I don't think it's a binary. I don't think it's either or. I mean, you're always playing instinctively. The moment you think, long ago I written a post on why sportsmen choke. And the reason is there is one part of the brain which is like on automatic mode. So you do something 1,000 times. It's like driving a car. When you're driving a car, you're not really thinking about how much to move the steering wheel and all that. Exactly. It's completely automatic. And there's another part of the brain which is very conscious of something. So you'll notice that when you do something that is very automatic, like your signature is automatic, but you try to actually consciously think about what your signature looks like and do it, and it might not come out the same. For example, when you're typing on a keyboard, you don't have to look at the keyboard, you know where all the letters are. But if you close your eyes now and you ask yourself where is A or where is S, you won't be able to do it. So sportsmen often choke when they go from the automatic part of the mind to the part of the mind which is consciously having to think about a process, because you simply cannot do that. But while you can never consciously think about, say, a shot you're playing or a ball you're bowling or whatever, you can consciously think about what is your intent, what is your immediate tactical imperative at that point in time. And obviously you've practiced both the defensive strokes, attacking strokes, all of that a million times in the nets, so you adjust accordingly.
Right. Amit, you wrote an article recently about how poker, lessons from poker can be applied to cricket, right? My first question to you is the answer, if I were to answer it, I'm always looking at it from a romantic point of view, right? I can never enjoy cricket as a percentage game or as anything else for that matter. But with poker, it is, the number is very clear, right? You're always playing probability, right? Even though you don't necessarily call it that, even if you're playing a kitchen game, there is a calculation in your mind, and it's more math in your mind than anything else, right? From a cricketing perspective, I think in one of the earlier episodes we did was with the gentleman called Ramki, who runs his company called Sports Mechanics. And we spoke at length about how the money ball advent happened to Indian cricket. And that was very, very late. I think the 2003 India tour to Australia was probably the first time that we took video analytics pretty seriously, and John Wright was responsible for a major part of that, right? I think today we've come to a stage where there is a lot more data at the administrative level. I think people are working on different models, people are identifying talent, etc. But from a audience perspective, I feel, there's very little avenue for us to appreciate the number part of sport, the math of sport, right? Do you agree with it? Is the market where we don't have an opportunity for that, right?
No, I agree with that. But and part of that is, I think the key feature of the market which makes it like that is that we have this unfortunate tendency for all our commentators and so on to be ex-players. Right. Now, where does your average cricket fan get his insights and knowledge from? It's from what ex-players are saying on TV while they're watching the match. And ex-players, some of them as old as in their 70s, are stuck in very old, outmoded ways of thinking, which were perhaps correct in their time, or might have worked for them in their time rather, but are not so suited to the present day. So you'll still find moments where somebody plays an aggressive shot and gets out, and it's a very simple sort of binary of, bad shot selection, right. As opposed to actually thinking through the expected value of that shot and that approach and breaking that down in terms of complexity. For example, if you are in a situation in an ODI game where you've lost a couple of wickets and there's a lot of pressure on you, without arguing for the merit of either approach, the thing is that, for example, if you're aggressive, when you play that aggressive stroke, when you step out and you tonk a guy for six, there is an expected value that follows that X percent of the time you'll get the six, X percent of the time the bowler will change his length, then you can maybe rock back and hit the next short ball for another six, and so on. And that can change the momentum and that can change the game. And everything comes down to numbers, which nobody knows, but you can kind of approximate those numbers. And in fact, our understanding of those numbers and those probabilities have changed, because what I often argue is that one of the things we learned with the T20 revolution was that the value of aggression is underrated even in one-day cricket. And you see this in the sense of, you know, Sunil Gavaskar celebrated his 70th birthday recently. And when he started playing one-day cricket, when one-day cricket started, he played that infamous innings of 26 of 174 balls where he batted all 60 overs. Not his fault, because it was a new game. Nobody knew how to play it. And eventually he became a very good one-day player. He made that famous 100, you'll remember, in the 87 World Cup against New Zealand, magnificent innings. So the thing is, initially when one-day cricket began, people didn't know what the right approach is, and they were too slow, and they would bat 60 overs and make 220 and defend it. And then that changed over time, and the par score kept going up. And with one-day cricket, it has gone up even further, because people have realized that we were not being aggressive enough. The expected value of aggression is higher than it should be. And an illustration of that is really the dominant one-day team of this generation, which is England. Now, in the World Cup, they had that final. Maybe they, I mean, whoever wins is kind of lucky to win, because knockouts are a lottery anyway.
Right.
So, but regardless of that close finish in that low-scoring game, you look at England's scorecards over the last 4 years, and it's mind-boggling. It's a quantum leap up from what came before, because their approach is that they attack far, far more. Five of their top six are outstanding stroke players. And even the sixth is Root, but Root's role is more of a builder and an insurance and so on. But otherwise, these five and Alex Hales, who was in the team earlier, are fantastic stroke players. They bat much deeper. Their approach often has been just to go bang, bang, bang. Like at one point in this World Cup, they had a, at one point during this World Cup, they had a streak of seven consecutive scores of 300, stretching back to before the World Cup. And that only got broken because some team made 215 and then they had to chase it down. And obviously they can't make 300 chasing 215. And so I view what happened in the later part of the World Cup when those slow, low pitches kind of caught them out, and they won regardless, but as a bit of an outlier. And they changed the fundamental approach to the game. And you see that even, you know, I mean, West Indies winning the T20 World Cup by basically saying we won't follow the ODI template of you pinch it for the first few overs, then you build, then you slog at the end. No, their thing was, no, we'll front load, we'll attack the all 20 overs all the way through. And these are insights on the expected value of aggression that I argue have really come from T20 cricket, because that's where people figured out they need to attack more. And the second thing that happened was because T20 is where the money is. You know, very few people can break into test cricket in ODIs, but the pool of players who play T20 leagues is much larger. That incentivizes young players coming up to practice their aggressive strokes more than their defensive strokes. Now, this cuts both ways. I agree that if you're playing the moving ball at Headingley in England in an English season, batsmen aren't as good at shouldering arms and leaving a ball anymore, or playing the moving ball anymore. But that's a very low sample size of the kind of things that happen in cricket, and people don't really care about that. They want to make money in the T20 leagues. In terms of pure attacking strokes, I would argue that we have far better stroke players now across the board than in the history of the game. You know, starting with AB de Villiers and his whole 360 game.
Or any of the Fab Four. Cody, Warner.
Any of these guys, or any of even the hitters like Butler, Bairstow, Roy, they have strokes that you didn't have before. I remember watching the Under-19 World Cup, the one before the last one, the one where Ishan Kishan, Rishabh Pant, Sarfaraz Khan played. And I remember watching Arman Jafar in that World Cup and thinking that the boy is so textbook, he's so orthodox, everything is so right about him, even when he plays the scoop and the reverse sweep. Because those are now textbook strokes. So the risk to ratio of those shots has come down. Like when Mike Gatting played a reverse sweep in 87 and he cost England the World Cup, he hadn't practiced it so much in the net, so risk to reward ratio was higher. Now it's as much second nature as that classical cover drive is. So the way the game, and it's you know, I did a podcast with Gideon Hay, the great cricket writer, once, and he told me that the fascinating thing he found about the 2015 ODI World Cup was that the batsmen were doing T20 batting and the bowlers were doing test match bowling, because the bowlers had adapted to this new aggression from the batsmen with their own kind of aggression. So that whole stereotype that it's a batsman's game and bowlers can only bowl slower balls and restrictive bowling is rubbish. I mean, that's part of the reason why wrist spinners are so much in vogue today in T20 cricket and ODIs. You know, where even we let a great bowler like Ashwin go, and we brought in Kuldeep and Chahal, because wrist spin is more fundamentally attacking and likely to take wickets.
Absolutely.
So the game is going through such a fascinating phase in the last few years that it's beautiful.
You spoke about England's score over the last, you know, the streak that they had over seven games. If you were to only focus on the semi-final and the final, right, where it was 240. There was a stark difference, and someone tweeted about this yesterday as well. India's chase against the 240 and England's chase against the 240, very, very different after 4 or 5 wickets down, right? Dhoni's approach, of course, which has come to, you know, a lot of criticism, was very different. He was trying to save it for the last 5, 6, 7 overs. Whereas the partnership between Stokes and
Butler,
yeah, that was a more of an accumulation piece, right? That's I would have assumed if Pujara was playing for India, he would have played exactly like that, right?
Kind of different, because Butler was batting at a run a ball, and Stokes was batting at about 60 or 70 actually, which I don't think Pujara would have managed.
Yeah, but very, when compared to Dhoni's innings with this, it's this very, very different piece, right? Do you think there was a number that Dhoni was looking at? Was he looking at this chase very, very differently?
I think he was, and I think he was wrong. And I'll tell you why. See, I'm a great admirer of Dhoni, firstly. You know, in an earlier era, the greatest chaser in one-day cricket by far. But Dhoni's approach was this. Dhoni was, first of all, playing at a time when power scores were lower, when 300 was outstanding, and he would often be chasing 260, 270. And his approach was, and you're a poker player yourself, you mentioned, so you'll appreciate this. His approach was a classic exploitative poker approach, which is basically what you exploit your opponent's mistakes.
Right.
So he recognized, he would recognize during a chase, that under high pressure, people make mistakes. And he would say that I will not make mistakes myself in terms of trying to accelerate too much. I will wait for the crunch in the last couple of overs when the other guy will make mistakes. We're trying to bowl a yorker, he'll bowl a full toss, or trying to bowl wide yorkers, he'll actually bowl wide and stuff like that, and I'll exploit those.
Which is the equivalent of folding as many hands as you possibly can, but when you're playing, you go slightly more aggressively on that hand?
Not sure if that works, but it was basically the equivalent of saying that, look, you know, I am going to avoid making mistakes myself, and if this guy makes mistakes, I'll get him. And the whole thing was, his thing was, if you need 8 and over for 9 overs, I don't mind batting at 6 and over if that reduces the risk. And then in the last 2 or 3, when you need 12 and over, the other guy will make mistakes because the pressure will be too much. I'm Mr. Cool, I won't. That worked for him in a previous era. It doesn't work for him in this era because par scores tend to be larger. And it's not 8 and over you have to chase in the last 8, it's 10 and over you have to chase in the last 12.
Yeah.
And if you leave it for the end, when you know, you have to chase, say, 15 and over for the last 3, it becomes insurmountable. And also during this period of time, Dhoni's skills have waned, and bowlers, because of T20 practice, have become much better at bowling at the death. Right. So he's not going to get those gimmies and those mistakes anyway. But what I'd point out in looking at the England chase and the India chase is that I would like to postulate a key statistic that I think people should incorporate into the way they look at cricket and analyze cricket, which is the strike rate of the required run rate. Like when a batsman gets in, there's a required run rate. So the strike rate required to bat at that rate minus his actual strike rate. And if that number is negative, I would argue that that batsman is a liability to his team, to the exact extent of that number multiplied by the number of balls he faces. So for example, in the semi-final, Dhoni comes out and the required rate is 9 and it's rising, it goes to 10, 11, etc. Dhoni makes 50 of 72. Okay, to me that is criminal. It's a crime, because what is happening is that one, he is way slower than that.
Right.
B, and you can justify, people have tried to justify it by saying that he's keeping one end up and letting Jadeja do the hitting. But then the point is Jadeja himself wasn't faster than the required strike rate, though he tried very gamely and played a great innings. Secondly, you're the freaking senior batsman. Why are you making your batting partner's job harder by being a liability to the team and taking up deliveries? So if you look at the if you look at the way Butler and Stokes approached it, their scene was that we'll take it deep, yes, but we'll keep scoring at a very good clip. I think together they must have scored their partnership at a strike rate of 80 or something,
right,
when the required score was pretty low also, right? So it didn't hurt the team. It didn't leave an insurmountable job for the guys to come after. Though obviously New Zealand bowled magnificently, Butler gets out, it's very dramatic, but
right.
You know, and you see that approach not just in Butler and Stokes, you see that approach before that in Root and Morgan, where typically Indian batsmen in the place of Root and Morgan would do tuk 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 and take it deep to 40 when you need 12 and 13 and over, and then wickets will tumble and you'll go. But Root and Morgan, they got out playing aggressive strokes, but I think the aggressive intent was correct. Hmm. Like Root got out playing a stupid attacking shot against Cole in the Grandham because they targeted that guy as, this is a bowler against whom our aggressive EV is higher, we can get him for more runs. So I would say that approach is completely correct. It backfired. And then they managed to get a win anyway. And it's a mind-blowing game where really we both agree both teams deserve to win. It's kind of sad that someone has to lose out. But
awesome. That's a wonderful place for us to take a very short break. When you come back, I'm going to ask you if you would have described this differently had Dhoni reached and then probably even won the match for us. But do stay with us. We'll be right back on the Filter Koffee Podcast.
Hey everybody, welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you are not following us on social media, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcasts on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Do remember that if you enjoy what you're listening to, take a screenshot, tag us on social media, and we'll repost you on one of the platforms. Also, just, you know, shout out if you want to tell us anything about what's going on. Also, a quick reminder, we are still hiring. We're hiring in a whole bunch of different areas. If you're looking to work at what I believe is the best place on earth to work at, then you should check out our careers page. That's at ivmpodcast.com/careers. On the scene and the unseen, Amit Varma is joined by one of his most frequent guests, Vivek Kaul. They discuss the budget announced for the year 2019-2020 and answer listener questions in the second half. On The Origin of Things, Chuck narrates the story of Purity, an outdated beverage, and a business deal. On Not Just Dansak, Parzan talks to Kaina's contractor, co-founder Rustam's Parsi Bonu, restaurant that serves home-style Parsi food in Delhi. On Geek Fruit, Tejas and Jishnu are joined by stand-up comedian Rohan Joshi. They talk about the new Spider-Man movie, Far From Home. On Advertising is Dead, Pratish Mepani, founder and creative director at Starting Monday Design and Branding Company, talks to Varun about how the concept of design in India has evolved over the years and the importance of it in trade and business. On Pulia Bazi, Pranay and Saurabh are joined by Anup Rajput, engineering head at Incus Technology, to discuss semiconductor microchips, their supply and manufacturing, and how it affects geopolitics between India, China, and the US. On the Empowering series, Zarina is joined by Ambar Rana, founder, Corpus Legal, and host of the podcast Know Your Kanoon. They talk about gender equality, the importance of diversity at the workplace, and gender neutral laws. On Golgappa, Tripti talks to Anuya Jakatdar, co-founder of Books on Toast, about her love for books and what it was like growing up in a Marathi household. And with that, let's continue on with your show.
Welcome back to the Filter Koffee Podcast. We are speaking with Amit, and we were discussing cricket, and for the first time in the episode, you mentioned EV, which is a term we'll use more frequently in this half of the episode. I mean, before we went on a break, you know, you were talking about how this was not necessarily the right approach by Dhoni. But I'm just wondering, firstly, I don't agree that as a senior player, he has to play any differently than as a junior player, right? I think one of the things that I always loved about Dhoni is, and this shows even in the way he hires for CSK, right? He doesn't hire talent, but he hires people for roles, which is why CSK is not a, you know, sometimes it's a probably the oldest franchise in terms of average age. But everyone has a role, right? So was Dhoni's role to just hold one end? Wasn't it by design that Ajay Jadeja was...
I think to some extent that's a rationalization of his current inabilities. Mm. In the sense that, look, I would be okay with Dhoni playing slower than par if the partnership is going along at the rate that it should. Mm. But it wasn't. The partnership was also much slower. The pressure on Jadeja, and Jadeja is a very underrated player, but he's still a lesser batsman than Dhoni. You know, so to expect him to pull it off, I think was unfair. But we can agree to disagree there. But broadly, I think if you kind of look at the statistics that, you know, even chases that we won, for example, in this World Cup itself, there was an earlier chase where Dhoni actually batted quite slowly and we happened to win that. Earlier in the year, Dhoni, I think when India went to Australia, I think he was man of the series in the ODI, sir.
Yeah.
Because he made those runs and, Jadhav managed to finish a match and I think Karthik finished another match. But I thought, even at that time, I argued that we are winning, but the approach is wrong because I'm not results oriented. I'm just looking at the EV of the approach as per my judgment. And we can, of course, come to a different EV and, if we evaluate some parameters differently.
Right.
But I've just felt that, ODI cricket has kind of moved on. You can't do that thing where you leave something for too late and you think you'll get 15 and over in the last three. And also, here's the thing, that traditional thinking that the hitting must be left for the end is wrong, and England realizes this. It's wrong because think about it like this. Like, for a moment, forget the chase. Imagine that you're batting first. Right? T20 is sort of an easier illustration of this. And people say you should send your big hitter out with four overs left and he will do the big hitting, say Dre Russ. My argument is no, you send him at the start and you ask him to imagine that these are the last four overs and you ask him to bat as if these are the last four overs. Now, the EV of this, assuming there's no swing and seam in the pitch and all of that, and the conditions aren't different, and normally in T20s they're pretty much the same all the way through a match. Assuming those variables are the same, your EV of attacking in this 4 overs versus that 4 overs is exactly the same. With the difference that if you do it in 4 overs that are early on or in the middle, the guy might still be not out at the end of it and be able to carry that momentum on. So the overall EV of that approach of attacking earlier rather than later, of sending your hitters out first rather than later, is much higher than following the traditional format, given the caveat that the conditions shouldn't be such that it warrants a certain amount of caution. And in T20s, they really are.
Right.
So in that sense, if you look at what England did, for example, if England have that chase and they realize that, okay, we're going to have to be aggressive at some point, and Morgan says, I'll play those overs now. And Root says, I'll play those overs now, change the momentum, coast to victory. I don't think that's necessarily wrong thinking. And in the semi-final where they chased down that score against Australia so well, it worked for them.
Applying the same logic then, does it make sense, for example, and I remember, you had recently written about T20 cricket in a very unique way, where you had said that what you just said, which is you have to attack more at the beginning because the value of the wicket is much lower than the value of a dot ball.
Yeah.
Right? By extension, I always thought, does it make sense for us to entirely change the way we're looking at batting orders? What if the bowlers or what if the tailenders were to open the batting? And what if your best batsman were to come towards the end? Has anyone tried that?
Someone has tried that in a test match where, I think in the days of uncovered pitches, I absolutely can't remember who this was. Might have been Bradman as captain. I can't remember who this was for the life of me. But in the days of uncovered pitches, 50, 60 years ago, where there was an uncovered pitch and it was going to get better, so they send the tailenders out first because those wickets don't matter. But in general, I mean, tailenders, you never want them to bat first. But your question is a great one. And the thing is, depending on the strategy, yes. For example, think about this. If your strategy in a T20 is going to be front-loading, you've got a kind of batting pitch and you're saying, I'm going to attack from ball one to the end of the game. Now, the thing is, there are roughly, like I'm writing a book on cricket strategy where I expand on this, but there are roughly, I would say, two kinds of batsmen. I mean, it's a continuum, but roughly two sort of extremes, which are what I call builders and bashers, right? So builder will be a guy like a Williamson, a Kohli, a Root, though they can also do some bashing at times, but they are classical builders. Like Pujara is too much of a builder, which is why he can't get into the ODI side. And then you have the bashers, which are your guys like Butler and Dre Russ and Chris Gayle and all that, who are not necessarily bad batsmen or lesser batsmen, but they are great hitters. And they can also build if required. Now, what I would say is that if you're front-loading, what you should really do counterintuitively is send your bashers up first, have more bashers, send them up first, and keep a builder in the side for insurance. So if you lose 3-4 wickets early in the first 6 overs, then your whole EV of the game changes, your approach changes, your risk-to-reward ratio changes. Instead of having 11 resources for 20 overs, you might suddenly have 7 resources for 15 overs, out of which 4 are bowlers and can't really bat that well. In which case, your correct approach might be to build for another 10 overs and then hit, revert to the traditional template. So you have the builder coming out later. And for that reason, I think there are certain situations where even in the England lineup, they would be well advised to switch Root and Butler, where you have Butler coming at 3 and you have Stokes coming at 4 and Morgan 5 or whatever. Root is really the only builder in the team per se. Yeah. And you have Root there for insurance. But if it's a tough low scoring pitch, then I'd rather send Root out early so he can be the strong guy who makes sure that, you know, wickets aren't really falling. Hmm. How this would apply to India is that, you know, I think Kohli is just the greatest Indian batsman ever in terms of skills.
Right.
And the greatest ODI batsman ever from any country period. Yeah. But I think that he's an exceptionally good builder who can bash. So I think it's a question of roles. If he decides that I don't want to take the risk to reward ratio high by just going out and trying to score at a strike rate of 130, 140 straight off the bat, then he should actually slip down the order and send people before him and say, you just go for it. And by chance, if 4 wickets fall, main sambhal lunga. You know, so I think this is something that teams need to start considering, that if you do, you know, how, and it depends on the strategy on a given day, what approach do you want to take? If you're chasing 120 in a T20 game, or you're chasing 230 in a one day game on the kind of pitch there was in the final, then the approach changes. You don't have to hit from ball one.
So let's say you're making the decision and this is the semifinals, India, New Zealand. At what number will you send Dhoni in?
I won't have Dhoni in the side. He's a liability at any number. If you send him in earlier, he's going to consume more balls at a lower strike rate than net run rate and make the job even harder for the other guys. But overall, I think the Indian approach has been too slow. They play they don't understand that you have to, like England understands, that you have to maintain a certain steady minimum tempo throughout the game. Like, even before that, when Dhoni came into controversy for that game where he didn't even go for the win, there was no intent at all, him and Jadhav at the end. Even in that game, India lost an early wicket, and then I think Kohli and Sharma were together, or Kohli and Rahul, whatever. Kohli and Sharma were together. Sharma made 100, and they made 27 in the first 10. And were very slow in the next 10 after that. And the argument some people have given is they needed to preserve their wickets because they knew the middle order was incapable, which is a silly argument, because then why play the World Cup if you think any of your players are incapable?
Right.
So I think that 27 of 10 at the start is as criminal as Dhoni's slowdown at the end.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, you know, and it's easy for them to get away with it because they're not there at the crunch. What the viewer will see is that at the crunch moment, Dhoni is a guy who's being unable to make the runs. But if he's being unable to make the runs because the required run rate is 12 or 13, and if the required run rate is so high because those people were dawdling and getting the individual landmarks at the start, then that is a problem you need to look into.
You know, sometimes I often wonder if this is a very typical Indian problem, right? We in most sports, we err on the side of playing safe, right? Somewhere I'm just wondering if there is an economic impact. This is a very middle-class way of looking at anything in the world, right? You just make sure first that you survive, and then you can think about A, B, C, D, right?
I think that was probably true for an earlier generation, where individual performances mattered a lot. Because, see, look, up till the 80s, we were losing everything anyway. Yeah. So the incentive is naturally for a guy to say, let me make my individual score and keep my place in the side. To be very honest with this current bunch of guys, I have deep problems with Kohli's leadership and his strategic understanding. But I think that he's selfless in the sense that he will do anything for his team. He will not do something selfish. So I think when he bats slowly in those situations, it's actually genuinely to a lack of understanding. And you see that in the IPL also, where RCB is bottom of the heap consistently because he just strategically doesn't get it. He underestimates par scores constantly, doesn't get the rhythms of the game at all.
Yeah. We really think about it, more than the tactical aspect of it. Kohli's also struggled throughout his career with team composition.
Yeah.
Right? I think the most glaringly obvious example of this was the IPL and how RCB completely screwed up the playing 11 every single match almost, right? Do you feel the way that he has a huge team composition problem?
He has, you're absolutely right. You nailed it. He has a huge team composition problem. And this goes back to earlier times. Like, for example, another thing that I hold against Dhoni, for example, was that he had that conflict of interest situation with Riti Sports. Was an agency started by his friend.
Right.
He supposedly had a stake in it at one point, though he later said he sold it or he denied it or whatever. But you would see that clients of RT Sports were getting more opportunities for India than they should have. Like when we went to Australia the time before last, Karan Sharma, who hadn't really done anything in first-class cricket, went along and he was a client. You'll see that someone like Suresh Raina, who is a fantastic limited overs player but not really a test player, played more test matches than he should have because he was a client. So biases creep in. Now, I don't think there are similar kinds of biases with Kohli. On the other hand, what I do think happens with Kohli is that his strategic vision of the game will determine selection, right? Because if his strategic vision, because he's selecting players for roles, if his strategic vision of the game is wrong, then he will select the wrong players. You know, for example, at one point in Test cricket, it was kind of obvious that Pujara was not part of his plans. And the thing is, again, he misunderstood Test cricket. You know, Pujara would be a liability in the shorter forms of the game.
Yeah.
In Test matches, he's probably our most important player because there your aggression doesn't matter so much. How long you can stick at the crease and, you know,
aggression itself means something different in a Test scenario.
In a Test match, it means something different. I would argue that in many cases, when Pujara plays 80 balls in a Test match and makes 30 runs, he's actually being very aggressive because he's killing the new ball. You know, he's killing the energy of the other side. That is a form of aggression in itself.
Yeah.
So I think in all the different forms of the games, Kohli is kind of strategically inept. And I feel very bad saying this because I am a huge Kohli fanboy. Mm-hmm. As a batsman, I think he's the greatest of all time. In terms of character, despite, you know, all the gully galoch which people focus on, I also think he's a good guy. In some ways, he's a role model. If you look at his work ethic and the intensity with which he plays, you know, leave aside the occasional BC on the field, which is, you know, the whole West Delhi expression, but he's an absolute role model in those senses.
And he's also refined himself a lot while addressing the press.
Massively.
He speaks beautifully.
Massively.
Yeah,
he's just fantastic, and it's very Jekyll and Hyde that how can you know, like I say, in terms of batting he's a goat, but in terms of captaincy he's woat. And I obviously he's become such a great batsman by showing a lot of humility, in the sense that I think inherently if you have to reach greatness, you have to recognize your own mistakes and work on them incredibly hard because you want to avoid those mistakes. So you have to be honest with yourself about the things you're doing wrong. And I think obviously anybody who's a great batsman has that quality. And I wish he showed the same quality in his captaincy.
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, when you're talking about Pujara, this thing that Haydo once said came to mind, which is, I think it's Haydo. He said, get the label as aggression on the cricket field. But if you want to see true aggression, you should look into the eyes of Rahul Dravid when he's about face a ball, right?
Dravid when he's about to face a ball, or Anil Kumble after he broke his jaw bowling with that cast in West Indies. You remember that?
I remember that, but I think it's that one was a little too overhyped for me.
Maybe the media hyped it, but the bottom line was the guy fucking did that. He broke his jaw and he went out there and, you know, he did that. He put it on the line. And that's also a kind of aggression. Aggression is not just hitting fours and sixes. I mean, to me, look, aggression is doing whatever is, and I'm sorry if this sounds unromantic and mathematical, but aggression is doing whatever is the highest EV play at the moment with full intensity. The highest EV play could be trying to hit three sixes in a row. The highest EV play could be shouldering arms to a bowler who's bowling beautifully and knowing where your off stump is.
Right.
And if you do that with full intensity, that is aggression.
By the way, since we're using this term a lot, this is 3/4 into the episode, so a little late. But do you want to explain to the uninitiated what value is?
I'm so sorry. Apologies. This is one of those things which is so much a part of my language and thinking, I assume everyone must know it. EV means expected value. Your expected value is the outcome of a particular action, what it will result in. To give you a very simple example, supposing I come to you and I say that we will flip an evenly weighted coin. We know it's an evenly weighted coin. We will flip it. Every time it's heads, I give you 51 paisa. Every time it's tails, you give me 50 paisa. Right. Now, it is a no-brainer. You will take it because it's evenly weighted. On average, you will make money because I'm paying you 1 paisa more for every heads and you're paying me for tails.
Right.
And then you calculate what the EV of this is, and it's a plus EV move. If it was the other way around, it would be a minus EV move. So what in a cricketing context, what it would be is, for example, let's say, and I'm just thinking off the top of my head now, let's say there is one ball to go. Okay, let's look at the World Cup final. Let's look at the actual last ball where Stokes is playing and there's one run to tie and two to win. Okay. Except that if he goes for a 2, it requires a different stroke than if he goes for a 1.
Hmm.
Now, let's kind of break this down. Let's say that the satisfaction of winning is equal to the pain of losing. Let's assume. It's not always the case, but let's assume that that is the case. And let's mark that as 100. Okay. Hmm. 100 happiness points. You get minus 100 happiness points or plus 100 happiness points. Now, let's say that if he goes for a 2, which is basically trying to pierce the gap and get a boundary really, because whatever, if he goes for that kind of a shot, it's going to come off 20% of the time and 80% of the time he won't get it. So your EV for that particular shot is 20, right?
Right.
It's 20% of 100. Let's say that if he just decides to take a single, he'll get a single 90% of the time, and he will get a single at least 90% of the time, out of which for 30% he'll get a 2 also. He'll scramble a 2, and 10% there'll be nothing, right? So in that case, that 30% of the time, your EV is already above the risky shot. So whatever, let's say it's less than 10% of the time you'll get a 2, 80% you'll get a 1, 10% you'll be out. So your EV right now, from the time that you win it immediately with the scramble 2 by trying for a 1, is at 10. But the 80% of the time that it's a tie, assume that both teams are evenly balanced and you win 40% of those. You know, then that's another 40 happiness points added to the index. So your EV of going for the single and then trying to scramble a second rather than go for a boundary is 50, as opposed to the 20 of trying to go for a boundary. This is a very crude breakdown, and many other factors go into all of it. And it's not that Stokes is thinking of any of this. Stokes is thinking, to use a term you brought up earlier in the thing, what is a percentage play here? And the percentage play is to make sure we are alive by making sure I connect bat to ball and get the single. And if we manage to scramble a second, that's great. And it so happens that because players with experience, their instinct will often tend to match what is actually the mathematically correct play.
Right.
But often it won't, because they might be stuck in bad habits of the past.
So, did you also manage to watch some Wimbledon?
Yeah, I absolutely didn't. And I thought that, you know, Federer and Joker, they'll be playing finals till 2025. So let it be. I'll just watch the cricket. I'm not that much into tennis, to be honest.
Okay. So I wanted to apply your EV logic to that game. Mm-hmm. And then it's great that you haven't seen it.
Mm-hmm.
So basically what happened was, it was a marathon match. It's one of the longest finals ever. And Federer, when he was serving 11 games to 10 in the final set, he had 3 championship points. And I think the mistake he did was he wanted to be super aggressive and close it out immediately, right? And that also meant that he had to make an uncharacteristic move towards the net, which really cost him, because there was a beautiful backhand cross court from Joko, which really sealed the case, right? How did he do in your evaluation?
I didn't watch the match. 2, I don't know tennis well enough.
Right.
But I would simply say that we should not judge his choice by what it resulted in. Because a lot of it is random and comes down to luck. Maybe he made the right decision, and maybe his decision was more plus EV than the other decision. Maybe his was going to win 70% of the time as opposed to 65% of the time. But both of those mean that 30 and 35% of the time, respectively, the other guy wins. So I have no idea what his thinking was. Maybe he thought the greater aggression, like rushing to the net, will induce a mistake from Joker or whatever, or maybe he was simply not thinking along those lines and he was just very tired. I have no idea. But
possible,
I would caution against is that sitting outside and sort of judging the decisions people make by the results. I would say I would be very hesitant of doing it. So when I sort of judge how sportsmen are playing, I don't look so much at the results, but at their approach. That are they taking what I would consider to be, with my limited knowledge, a plus EV approach in these sports? You know, if the approach is wrong and it comes off, well, you know, I won't necessarily give them credit for that. And if the approach is right and it fails, I'll be like, okay, bad luck. You know, it's that old thing of process over results.
Right. Yeah. No, but just to borrow on something that you said earlier, I think in my assessment, it was more about Federer probably over indexing on the pleasure of winning the tournament rather than the agony of losing it, right? And actually, you know, to be fair, I think that was where the fans were as well. Mm. I don't feel that bad that Federer lost that match.
Yeah.
As much as I would have wanted him to win it, right?
Yeah.
You mentioned, you know, your life's just shifting gears, that your perspective to life changed ever since you started playing poker, right?
Mm-hmm.
You started looking at things in a very probabilistic manner. At what point did you stop wanting to be or stop being a professional poker player?
I stopped being a professional poker player, to be perfectly honest, for lifestyle reasons. Because, you know, in the 5 years that I was a pro or a semi-pro for the first part of that, I put on
and some... And that was in India, right?
That was in India, playing underground cash games and some tournaments, like I did the Asian circuit, Macau and Philippines and all that, for tournaments, but for cash underground cash games here. Maybe I shouldn't say this on record. Yeah, it was more for lifestyle reasons. I put on 20 kgs during that time and I stopped reading books. I stopped, like, you know, I have friends who are writers, who are economists, stopped hanging out with all of them. I felt that I became stupider during these 5 years. And also what I fundamentally wanted to do was write books. And then at some point I said that, you know, just let this be. I'll get back to what I'm doing. But poker definitely informed the way I look at the world, because you kind of realize the role of luck in everything, which people just don't get. So much of life is determined by sheer dumb luck. And, you know, when we do well, we tend to get more arrogant than we should be. When we do badly, we tend to get more disheartened than we should be. While, you know, the truth is that a lot of what happens to us, good or bad, a lot of it is just due down to dumb luck. And even when we think it's because of our own actions, even that is due to dumb luck in terms of how we are hired or how we are wired, rather.
Right.
How our brains are wired, what kind of people we happen to be for no fault of our own, what kind of family we are born into, what kind of social situation we are in, where of course you and I are, you know, incredibly lucky, way above the mean to just even be sitting here and having this conversation.
Yeah.
And it's good to be aware of that, because then that gives you the sort of the humility to work harder on yourself and not take things for granted.
There's a lot of Bhagavad Gita parallels to what you just said. But, you know, I had this theory. So many years back, when I was living outside this country, I came very, very close to being a professional poker player. Up until then, you know, I was largely playing kitchen games.
Mm.
You know, at that point, and thankfully, you know, I didn't pursue that for too long. But the theory that came to my mind during those days, you know, where I was playing almost every other day for cash games, is that I genuinely felt that I could equate every life decision to a decision I had to make on the poker table.
Mm.
Right? It got to a point where I was so convinced about it, you know, I actually made a film called River.
Mm.
It's a horrible film that no one should watch.
Where can we watch it?
Moving on. So, you know, where there is a poker game going on, it's an underground poker game, and then there is a heist. And the decision the protagonist has to make in both the scenarios are similar, right? And the game situations to the real life situation is also very similar. Have you ever thought of that? Have you ever thought that your life decisions somewhere mirror the kind of player you are on the table?
Okay, two answers to that. One is that I think what poker does is, and as a cash game player, you must have experienced it, is that the kind of emotional turbulence you go through as a poker player is off the charts. It's more than any other profession. Like, you know, in any other profession, if on March 1 you have a bad day, you have one bad day. In poker, if on March 1 you have a bad day, you can lose what you won in February. You know, and that has, and also we are all hardwired with something called loss aversion, which is that the pain of losing a lakh is always going to be more than the joy of winning a lakh, or even the joy of winning 2 lakhs or 3 lakhs or whatever, because you immediately take that for granted and you account that. But when you lose, you feel that much more. And also other kinds of tilt come into it. Again, a term you're familiar with, which for non-poker players basically means anger. Like, one of which, for example, is entitlement tilt, which was something that would happen with me, where I would be playing with players I thought were much worse than myself, but they would be getting lucky and sucking out, and I'd be getting angry. And as a consequence
from a skill perspective,
Right. And from as a consequence of that, I'd feel what is called entitlement tilt, and I'd start playing badly myself. You know, so the emotional angle becomes hugely important. But to kind of get back to poker and life, and it's, I'm going to look for this film, even if you don't want to tell me where to find it, I will watch it. And I did an episode on The Seen and the Unseen with an investor friend of mine called Mohit Satyanand, where we spoke about how A, poker and stock investing involve similar decisions, similar heuristics, and similar cognitive biases, and how the cognitive biases also apply to life. For example, an example I gave is a sunk cost fallacy, where somebody is in a big pot and somebody bets on the river and he knows he's behind, but he's like, "Maine already itna invest kiya hai pot mein. I have put so much in the pot, I have to call this." But that should not be a factor. Your factor should be the immediate odds given to you and whether it's a plus EV decision to call. The money that you've put in the pot is a sunk cost. And the sunk cost fallacy applies to everything in life. Like, you might go to watch a film and you've seen half the film and it's a shitty film, but you don't walk out in the interval because I've already invested time and money doing this. Or it's why, for example, more seriously, why women stay in bad marriages for so many years longer than they should. Because it's like, oh, I've already invested 5 years on this guy, 10 years on this guy, 15 years on this guy. And then it becomes a trap and entire lives get wasted because of that. And so, what poker kind of did was, when I thought explicitly about it, made me aware of a lot of these different fallacies and biases and made me aware of how they actually apply to life and the real world. And I've thought at different times of writing a book about this, but different matter, not happened yet. But
no, in fact, the sunk cost fallacy reminds me of this other thing that people do often, which is, you order something and then you eat it because you don't want to waste it. Right? Yeah. So you already paid the money for it, so it is sunk cost.
Or the other example I gave is, let's say that you've taken a tiffin from home or packed something from home and you go to your office and then your colleagues say, "Hey, let's go for lunch to that cool new Japanese restaurant," and you really want to go, but you're like, "Wo waste ho jayega yaar." And the point is, you've got to think of that as a sunk cost and think of
So I want to ask you as a last question, what has been your single most mind-blowing moment on a poker table? I'll tell you mine. So the first time I went to play in a casino was in Vegas, and this is really small place there called Treasure Island, which is not really known for its poker tables more than anything else. And that's my first cash game, and there's about 12 people sitting there, and it's a very hot day. And this gentleman who was in a white suit, fully cleanly shaved, gelled hair, with a pink tie, and I was sweating just looking at him. He came and sat next to me, and so that was the first hand, and he went all in. And the remaining like 7-8 of us, we folded, and then one guy called him. And eventually they played it out, and the white suit guy lost, right? So he showed his hand. He had a 2-3 suited. And, I asked him, "What were you thinking?" And the guy actually who won that hand, he had a queen in the hole, a pair of queens in the hole. So the white suit guy said that 2-3 is a potential straight flush. So I think that's the last I played in that casino, right? So I thought that was a really, really bizarre. What's your most bizarre moment on a poker table?
I've had many bizarre moments. So it's like when you play as much as I have, you kind of have tons of bizarre moments, tons of unbelievable beats. Like, one I remember is, I used to play this cash game, which was a fairly big cash game at an industrialist place. And there was a friend of mine who played with me, who was not such a good player, but who was also a kind of pro in terms of the time he put in. But he wasn't really a consistently winning player to that extent. And he had played very tight all evening on this really, really loose table, and waiting for a hand. And at one point, he finally gets a pocket pair and decides to set mine. So it's like he has a pair of twos, and the guy who's raising every hand, the big industrialist running the game, raises big, he calls. And I think both of them had stacks of a lakh each at the time. And my friend was going through a bad phase and really wanted a double up at this point in his life. And they reach the flop, and the flop has ace, deuce, eight, something like that, rainbow. So no flush draw, ace, deuce, eight, very dry board. He's hit his set of deuces. And he knows the other guy probably has ace, king, ace, queen, or whatever. And he's going to continuation bet, and he can make money. And the other guy continuation bets, and our friend raises with his set. And the other guy goes 80,000 on top, all in. And our friend calls. And now that guy has to basically hit a runner-runner full house. Right? That is the only way he can win the pot. And he hits a runner on a full house, and my friend's stack is gone. And he goes out to the balcony very quietly without saying a word and starts crying. And so, you know, that is, you know, those kind of swings and those kinds of heartbreaks I've seen with, I've literally seen people, I mean, you know, the thing with poker is, and something I'm sure even you've kind of figured out, is that it is one of those games which is on the intersection of science and gambling. There is a science to it where you can study the game theory and you can know, oh, this is game theory optimal, my ranges are balanced here, this is how I exploit his mistakes. But a lot of people that you play with are basically addicts. It's like a drug for them.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can, like, I used to write a poker column for the Economic Times, and I once wrote a column about this where I was playing a game with these builders in Washi. And there were three of us, two of us were pros, and there was this builder who was just blind betting, you know, huge amounts of money without even looking at his cards every hand, and he was high on cocaine. And the two of us are sitting waiting to basically stack him.
Right.
And then we were driving back home after that. We were both, despite having come out on the winning end, very disturbed by that. We said, how are we different from drug dealers who are exploiting somebody else's addiction? Because on that table, it's not the same game being played. You know, I am playing one game, and that guy is doing something else entirely. And how is that? So when you, and obviously you can rationalize it and say that these are consenting adults. They've all signed up for this. It's okay. But at some level you feel, and this sort of zero-sum nature of poker, that you only win when somebody else loses, and that somebody else may not even be on the same page as you. Because if that somebody else is also a guy who's thinking about the math and the game theory and all that, it's an honest, competitive, this thing. But the other guy basically in the long run has no chance.
Right.
And it's, you know, and it's zero-sum. And I thought anything else I do in life, I will benefit. It's a positive sum game. I benefit by making others better off.
Yeah.
Right? Like, both of us are doing this podcast because we are both getting joy out of it. Yeah. None of us is exploiting the other person. And hopefully our listeners are getting the same joy.
Yes.
So, but poker is not like that. It's a zero sum game, even a negative sum game, because the house gets the rake. And that can have terrible consequences for people who are, so there is that ugly side to it where, you know, initially when I got into poker, I fell in love with the math and the strategy and all of that. And I was an evangelist for the game. And now I'm not an evangelist for it. I don't ask people to, you must take up playing poker and all that.
Because this is one of the,
I've seen that dark side also.
Right. Was that one of the big main reasons why you didn't, why you're not a pro player?
To be honest, there were a multitude of reasons. And in fact, I'll send you a link to a column I wrote about why I quit, which was the last installment of my column for the Economic Times on poker. So I'll send you that. Maybe you can link it for your listeners. But so there were lifestyle reasons and there were other reasons I wanted to get back to writing. Also, while I was profitable consistently, my whole plan of playing poker was I'm going to make you money and then I'm going to quit and I'll do what I want.
Yeah, yeah.
And it didn't scale up to that level for me because I realized that to get into those kind of big money games, you need access, you need political skills, social skills, all of those things, which are a whole different skill set, which I didn't possess. So I was like, forget it. Why am I wasting my life doing this? And okay, I've saved enough. Maybe I'll earn a little less for the next couple of years. But at least, you know, the constant anxieties that come with being a player will be gone.
Right. You spoke about your column in the Economic Times. We usually end the episode by asking the guest, what are they reading, watching, and listening to at this point? What are you listening to these days?
What I listen to is mostly comfort music. I've reached the age, I'm in my 40s, where I don't really discover new stuff anymore. But in terms of reading, I read far more than I watch stuff. So I read a lot of nonfiction and history and so on. And I watch things once. So, just last night I finished watching Chernobyl, the series on Hotstar.
Ah, okay.
Which is really great. But what I'd recommend to all your listeners is they should check out this book by Adam Higginbotham called Midnight in Chernobyl, which is far better, really comprehensive. Like, Chernobyl, the series, is beautifully made, but dramatizes some things for impact and all of that. And Midnight in Chernobyl is a deep look at what really happened there. And then you begin to understand that this is not so much a cautionary tale about nuclear power per se, but about the nature of the state and about human nature.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Amit.
My pleasure. Thank you for inviting me.
Speak to you soon. Cheers. So that was our show. If you like this podcast, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can listen to us on the IVM podcast app or ivmpodcasts.com. You can also follow us on our social media. We are at IVM Podcasts on Twitter and Instagram. And if you want to reach out to me, I am the_Karthik. That's Karthik with an H on Twitter. And Filter_Koffee, that's Koffee with a K, on Instagram.
Hey guys, I'm Mikhail Almeida. I host a podcast with my co-hosts Akash Mehta and Siddharth Reja on the IVM app. It's called What a Player.
What a player.
WADDAPLAYAH, because illiterates can't find it on their own.
No, and the H at the end is very important. What a player.
Yeah. And it comes out every Thursday on the IVM app. Tune in, we discuss everything sports, all sports. Yeah.
Mainly cricket, other sport in the middle, sandwich.
What happened to your language skills? Don't worry, he talks better on the show.
Yeah.
It's so, a great show. It has all things, including cricket and things around sports as well.
Yeah.
And some personal life.
As you can see, we're a very united podcast. And if you want to listen to us, tune in to us every Thursday on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com.
Did you know that Parsis in Mumbai, instead of being left at the Tower of Silence after they die, are now cremated? And why? Because a cow fell sick in the early 1990s. Did you know that the smog in Delhi is caused by something that farmers in Punjab do and that there's no way to stop them? Did you know that there wasn't one gas tragedy in Bhopal, but three? One of them was seen, but two were unseen. Did you know that many well-intentioned government policies hurt the people they're supposed to help? Why was demonetization a bad idea? How should GST have been implemented? Why are all our politicians so corrupt when not all of them are bad people? I'm Amit Varma, and in my weekly podcast, The Seen and the Unseen, I take a shot at answering all these questions and many more. I aim to go beyond the scene and show you the unseen effects of public policy and private action. I speak to experts on economics, political philosophy, cognitive neuroscience, and constitutional law so that their insights can blow not only my mind, but also yours. The Seen and the Unseen releases every Monday. So do check out the archives and follow the show at seenunseen.in. You can also subscribe to The Seen and the Unseen on whatever podcast app you happen to prefer.